And when we get there, I just want you to see it. One with God, one with another. That's our topic. Come on, Zach. For you that don't know, this is the youngest grandson. The young man sitting over on the side that took up an offering, one of them is the great-grandson of me. This is, am I great? No. I'm just a grand, of you, I'm a grandfather. Right. See, in order to get, the more, I'm not great.
Not that you're not great. You're great.
You know, the older you get, the more generations you have to sort out. And that gets a little difficult after a while. So anyhow, all right. So you have Jace, who just took up the offering, you and Steph. Your mother, count these. Can you count them?
She had me.
She had you. So that's two. Well, actually, and so we have one, two, three generations right there. This one and Ruth is four. Is that right? Four already?
You're getting old.
My dad was five. My dad and mother were five. Dad's mother and dad, my grandparents, is that six?
Where are you going?
I'm saying six generations of children of God.
Amen.
Yeah. And you get to be in that lineage. Okay? And so without any more, you're going to listen to Zach, and then we'll introduce Diane, and we'll go from there this morning. Welcome.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Yeah. I'm going to move your stuff a little. Are you guys starting to understand that Pastor wants us to exercise our spirit man? We're getting an opportunity to do that, praise God. All right, now I'm going to start with a little bit of a story and illustration. He let us experience on our vacation when we were in Marquette. I learned that I would have about, well, he said 15 to 20, and he since had mercy on me and said 10 to 15 cents right before we went on vacation. So it's not a surprise that God started talking then. But as Steph and I were driving down through Marquette, we got behind a young man who had a bumper sticker that said, "I was born okay the first time," on it. And after I got done verbally abusing him, and having what I would consider a common unchristian Christian response, three things were brought to my mind fairly quickly. First of which, at least the young man understood that he needed to be born again. He had a leg up on stuff. Second, I'm sure we weren't the only ones that have ever seen that bumper sticker. There's other families that have driven down. And it's at least created an opportunity to have the conversation about it with her spouse, with her child. So another good instance, I guess, if you can say, come out of that. The third one kind of gave me a little bit of a chuckle, because here you've got a young man in a college town that has probably had more than one of his fellow classmates ask him about that bumper sticker. And he, unaware, no matter how small it may be, has had an opportunity to preach part of the gospel to them, unaware. So, I give that illustration to start out saying that he's going to accomplish what he wants to accomplish with or without us. He would rather do it with us, and even with, in this case, with someone that thinks they're getting one over on him, he's still accomplishing something with it. Now, he wants to do it with us, okay? And we should want to. We receive blessings of that. by that. So, with that said, we all know that we can be fully equipped disciples. Everything that Christ has is available to us. I'm a visual guy. I like to think of it as a big, wide tunnel between us and God. We're at one end, God's at the other. The only thing that is in between there, if you want to say that, is it's a shutter on our end. It's not on his end. But we control, based on our choices that we make, we determine really how much of what he's made available we'll get through. Okay? It's all determined by us and our choices, actions. He never pulls away from us. He never diminishes what he has provided for us or made available. We have the fullness of God available to us always. Tunnel on his capacity, or on his side, is to capacity. All right, so there brings up the question of how do we open the shutter on our side? We've for the last 4 or 5 years, we've talked about building a relationship with God, building a relationship with Jesus. We have to live it. There's no substitute for it. There's no shortcut. With a lasting relationship with Jesus, there is no instant Jesus. He's instantly there, but you don't instantly have that confidence. Maybe we should. But we gain confidence with a relationship, the confidence to know that what we ask in his name will happen, will have. Okay? So how did we start this relationship with Jesus? Romans 10:9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. We believed in our hearts and we confessed with our mouths. We spoke. So that relationship started with a decision in our hearts, not a thought in our mind, but a confession from our mouths, with our mouths. What passes our lips has an effect not only on this world, but the spiritual as well. That's proof of that right there. 2 Corinthians 4:13. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Now, I've never had a problem keeping in mind the decision parts of being a Christian. He is working on me and emphasizing with me the emphasis, I guess, of the spoken words portion. How I speak to him, how I speak to another, how I speak to the world. The only way to make sure that what I'm speaking is what I'm supposed to be speaking is to pour the word of God in. We know that out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. We don't, I guess, Luke 6:45. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. So what do we need to do? We need to read. We need to listen. We need to speak the word of God into our hearts. Think of all the things in your family that provide an instantaneous response. Not real serious stuff, but stuff that, you know, you're going along and what do we got? We've got somebody struggling with something, can't figure it out, saying, I don't know what, I can't figure this thing out. What do we tell them? Gotta be smarter than what they're working with. And it's just like that. It's instantaneous, right? It's hot and muggy out. Grandma, she's famous for this one. She's always saying, I'm hot. Then as soon as that comes out, that's your opinion, Grandma. I mean, it's stuff that comes to mind almost instantaneously. You don't have to think of it. And I pray that is the way with spiritual responses will be that quick as well. That it's just there. We don't have to think about it. All right. I'll get into... there is something I am supposed to share with you that has worked for me. Certainly been a benefit to me. If it's not for you, don't worry about it. But I feel led to share it. I've always been a bit of a silent prayer, okay? I will close my eyes, and I'll turn inside to find him. Works great for me. When there is chaos, you find peace, you find calm. I've just always done it that way. Not necessarily horribly recently, but recently enough he wants me to talk about it. A problem would come up. And it shouldn't surprise us that when we get occupied with things of this world, that it would come up. But who shows up when you're praying? Thief. What does he come to do? Cast doubt. Steal from you. Take what's yours. And it should. It should not be a surprise that occurs when we're not walking as closely with him as we should. That's his opportunity, and he does not miss opportunities. But he shows up and he throws arrows at you. That's not going to happen. You're not worthy enough for that. So, does it surprise you, I guess, that in where we're in Ephesians, we're putting on the whole armor of God, that he has us do that before we pray? But I think it's 13. I've got 13 through 17. We're putting on our armor. 18 first, we pray. We need the armor. When he starts shooting the arrows at us, that's the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet. It protects us. It guards us. Needless to say, I probably let my armor get a little rusty, and it was affecting my prayer life. So I had enough of that. And along with concentrating on my relationship with him more, I started to pray out loud more. Okay? I started speaking the Word of God, reading the Word of God out loud. You see, for me, a spiritual happening was taking place there. And the spoken Word of God, like we said, has an effect not only in this world, but the spiritual world. But not that I guess before I hadn't been filling myself, but apparently I wasn't filled up. Satan was taking advantage of that. But as I spoke the Word spoke to me, and I was getting filled, and it was forcing him out, okay? Now, I'm not saying that unspoken prayer is not effective. I do recognize, though, that there's power in sending the Word forth from our mouths. Really, I mean, if you think back, for me, anyway, a lot of the times that I felt closest with God is when I'm speaking out loud to him. It brings my confidence up. Think of all the things that have made you talk to God out loud. Serious, serious stuff a lot of the time. There's power in separating what comes out of your mouth with everything else that runs through your mind. And you control that 100%. With that, right there. The mind is, without a doubt, I mean, you've heard devil's playground, all those types of things. It is the spot to where we are the most vulnerable, or one of our most vulnerable spots. Satan knows that, okay? And there are all kinds of nasty things that run through your mind. Maybe I'm sharing too much here, but I mean, there's things that have gone through my mind. I think, how can you call yourself a Christian and have that thought go through your mind? It just proves that Satan is very real and that we need to guard against him. Well, this he kind of threw in here, so I'm going to pay a little close attention to this, but If you are a silent prayer, and haven't gotten to the place to where your internal prayers are coming from a different place than where you do your logic and reasoning, your partially renewed mind, you are setting yourself up to be attacked and have doubt and unbelief. Because whether consciously or subconsciously, you will start comparing those things that are of God and not of God as similar, coming from the same place, and that creates a conflict. That robs you of your confidence. God is not going to talk to you in the same location that Satan is going to attack you. They're not alike. They have no business together. They're not going to be together. So you have to find that still small voice that you got to seek out that, and then you will know that you know that you know that you know you are hearing from God. So for me, I have found speaking my prayers and requests to God strengthens me. Again, not only the only way to get things done, just it has been a benefit to me. Now, there are certain circumstances that he does specifically instruct us to speak. Sickness, disease, demons, obstacles in your life that keep you from living a victorious life. He shows us by example in Luke 4:39. And he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her. And immediately she rose and ministered unto them. Now, it fascinates me that a lot of the things that we don't readily give an identity to, speak and hear. You know, he spoke to the fever. Do you think the fever heard him? You bet it did. It left immediately. Like that. It was gone. When you're praying to affect something, pray out loud, speak it, and then don't contradict yourself in other speech. Your thought life will take care of itself. As you're filling yourself with a word and continuing to put it in, your thought life will come into divine order. All right? So don't give the thoughts power. Don't pay a mind. Second example is when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead in John 11:43. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." Now, it's an interesting to me, is that when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." In that next verse, Lazarus comes out with his hands bound, his feet bound, his head covered, and I would argue with you, did not have enough time to make a decision to walk out of that grave. I think when Jesus spoke to that flesh moved. His feet were bound. He had been scooting. You know, how far do you get when you got your feet bound and your hands bound? That flesh was going out that door whether he knew what he was doing or not. He was coming. And just amazes me. Third example I'll give you is in Mark 1:40-42. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him and kneeling down to him and saying unto him, "If thou wilt, thou canst make me clean." And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand, touched him, and said unto him, "I will, be thou clean." As soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed. Not as soon as he touched him, not as soon as he saw Jesus, as soon as he spoke it, the leprosy left. The leprosy heard him. The word of God went forth and did its work. Jesus' weapon was speaking the word of God. Revelations illustrates that perfectly in the double-edged sword coming out of the mouth. We get our, well, back to Ephesians 6. When we're getting the rest of our armor, we get our offensive weapon, sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now, there's a reason why the disciples were instructed to speak to infirmities. Speak and send the word forth to do its work. When the word's been sent forth, your mind cannot stop it. You've spoken it into existence out of the abundance of your heart. Okay? Now it's out there to where the Holy Spirit can get a hold of it and do what he wants to do with it. So often we're focusing on the negative things that we say that Satan can get a hold of, and rightfully so, because that can throw your life into just as many tumbles as anything else. But yes, guard your mouth. Don't let idle thoughts run through your mind and out your mouth, but also understand the power that is in the spoken word of God. You know, we will train our bodies in a lot of things, but we seem to neglect speaking the word of God. If we're speaking the word of God to others, using it ourselves, it will be more natural and effective. With that said, don't get me wrong, the Holy Spirit better be doing the talking. I'm not saying just become a great orator. Just become a great orator. You still need to get your source. But as we talk with him, we speak with him out loud, speak to others, you know, we fill up our hearts. We fill up our spirit, man. And when the time comes to pray with others and tell them about Jesus, we are used to the words that are coming out of our mouth. Father, we thank you for the power of your spoken word. As Pastor said, we come expecting of you. We thank you for being here. Please be with Pastor, and please be with Diane, and may your message from them seat itself in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before you go away, go back in here. Where did you say you went inside?
Right.
Repeat that. Can you repeat it?
Yeah. Well, no. Well, yeah, you look in. You don't look. I guess what's the best way to explain it? Yeah.
Up. Yeah, go ahead.
Am I on?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I know the best way to explain it. I just know that it's not here. When I look into him, it's like I'm pulling away from everything else is around me and looking here. And it has a different tone. It has a different voice. It has a different, I mean, it's different. You can tell.
It's not you.
It's not you. It's not your normal mind. It's not your normal thoughts. You never, ever, ever have those, like we were talking, those thoughts that come into the mind that you think, whoa, I missed it somewhere. What's the matter with me?
They never come
in here.
Okay.
But here's, all right. And this we're renewing. This we're continually renewing.
Okay.
It's not renewed completely.
Thank you. It is. Are you shaking?
I am shaking. Piece of God. That's what I like.
That's very important to me that we all catch that. It comes from here. He that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. It's here. He is here. Now, Diane is going to come in a moment, and she's going to share, and I don't think that what she's going to share probably come from here.
No. I wasn't thinking that at all.
You see, so here's another step. What we're going to hear now, and it will be direct, it will be blunt, would you say? It'll be blunt. Well, that will follow through, because there's a point in the message, and I may adapt the message a little, but we'll see. And it's going to be blunt also. So it's a blunt day. Just relax in that.
And it's a time in history to be blunt. Because as Jan was saying, it's just a little longer. And she said that to her friend, that it's just a little longer, that she was going to turn the corner. But it's just a little longer, and we're going to turn the corner. We are going to go out of here as the glorious church, and then we're going to go out of here. But until we do, we have work to do. And after the last time I prophesied, I'm telling you, all the hounds of hell were after me. And I've had a very rough 2 weeks. I've had my body attacked physically. I've had my marriage attacked. I've had my stand on biblical issues attacked because I shared with my daughter-in-law that I do not believe in gay marriage. She's not speaking to me. And just on and on and on, I stepped on a yellow jacket, and my entire foot was on fire for the whole day. But I and my shield of faith has dents all over it from the evil one. But I'm still here, and I'm still standing. And I pray that you people will lift the people, the spokesmen especially, up. Pastor Lynn, Pastor Angela, Pastor Dale, Paul Bybee, who's a tremendous prayer warrior. Lift us up and pray for us, because we become under tremendous attacks for speaking out, and Satan does not want us to speak out, and he does not want to hear the words that God has put in our mouths, but we're going to speak them anyway. And I gave this first prophecy. I heard it in November of 2011, and I was in a church at that time that I was not able to give that prophecy. And I said to the Lord, why are you giving me these words, and I can only deliver them to just a few people that receive them? And he said to me, right now, you deliver them to the few, but there will be a time when you deliver them to the many. And so I want to share this prophecy first. The church at the time of the great falling away, which is already taking place, people who are unwilling to go through his shaking, pruning, purging process, and those who do not want to give up the things of the world and the desires of the flesh, people who are unwilling to yield to his will, will fall away, and they will join the church of the great apostasy, full of false doctrine and New Age movement, which is not new, but it's full of the old Muslim, Hinduism, and a few other twists and turns. This church will unite with all the world's religions to join with the world to persecute the true body of Christ. The true church are those who have completely yielded to Christ and his purposes at this time in history, which is to unite, to bring forth, to bring in the harvest of lost souls. The church of the great apostasy will try to disprove the true movement of God by not believing his word or following it, declaring his very words false, persecuting the church in the media, TV, and in the internet. However, all this attention will only not hinder, but help the real movement of God. Many believers will be harassed, hunted down, and even killed during this time. Abide in Christ, steadfast in faith, overcoming the world with the most powerful weapon of all, Christ's love. It said in 2 Thessalonians 2:3 that in this prophecy he's talking about the church of the Antichrist, the apostasy of law, the lawlessness of man. 2 Thessalonians 2:7 is lawlessness is already at work. 2 Thessalonians 2:11, he is allowing them to believe what is false and even sending them a deluding influence to them. 2 Thessalonians 2:10, they did not receive the love of the truth. They thought they received the truth, but they did not know the truth giver. And 1 Timothy 4:1 and 2 says, in later times, some will fall away from the truth and follow the doctrine of demons. Their own conscience will be seared. I believe that this church is a forerunner of the one world religion, the great harlot of Revelation. This church will have elements of all religions and will join with Islam and become the church of the Antichrist. I don't know if we will see that church, but we have already seen the forerunner of that church. The church will embrace all religions, telling the people who are left on this earth that all paths lead to God, and we are all one, so embrace it and live in peace. I am saying 2 Chronicles 12:13, as the Lord lives, what my God says, that I will speak. Mark this day in history, and I'm talking about Wednesday, the day that the Pope came to America. And this is significant in history because the Pope is the head of the Catholic Church and a very significant member of the Christian representation. And the Lord allowed this man to come at this time because he's bringing the church forward and center stage. And he says, mark this day in history because it is the beginning of my true saints against the apostasy, which is what is happening, for what is happening in our own lives will be seen as unimportant in comparison to what is about to emerge. Watch as the beast is starting to form, almost as if out of thin air, as the plan is forming for world domination. This time of the Antichrist is being put into motion. Watch and see the events emerge, for the end of the age is right before your eyes. Look up, for your redemption draws nigh. Hold fast to what you have, lest it slip away unnoticed. Prepare for battle. Put on the armor of God. You're going to need it. And take your stand. Do not lose your focus, for the church is about to take center stage. Put your eyes on me, for great and true is the Lord of hosts, the leader of heaven's armies. Stay true, stay focused until the end, when I come for you. I have written on the hand of my warriors, faithful and true. So take up your weapons and continue to fight. Now is not the time to be distracted or to be in fear. For faithful is the one who called you, and faithful is he to deliver the kingdom into the hands of the Father, strong and fearless, arrayed in scarlet and with all her banners flying. And you know I am talking about the glorious church, not that pathetic apostasy. But my loved ones will deliver a glorious church to the Father. It will soon be, very soon, my dear ones. Take up your places in the kingdom, alive in glory, alive in power, draped in the prayers of the saints, and dripping with the blood of the martyrs, along with the blood that I have shed for the kingdom. Your battle cry is the cross, and all who are mine will line up behind it and charge the kingdom of darkness and overcome it with my blood. Keep fighting and do not give up. The victory is ours. And that, this is so true, because the victory is ours. It's already been given to us. And as Andrew said, you know, speak out the words. Speak out his words. And because we overcome with the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, the word of that testimony is his words. And if we stand on that, we will be attacked, but we are victorious. We have the victory.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Amongst all that you've heard so far this morning, there's a place in there for the stable Christian to be rock solid. Father, we thank you. You provided strength to each one of us to be rock solid in you, to not be pushed about, bandied about, moved. We are upon the solid rock, Christ Jesus, and we have determined within ourselves that we'll stay the course, the length of time, and we will be victorious here in this life with you until we exit here and be with you. And we're going to spend some time this morning talking about you, us, and others. Break the bread of life. Let it be bite-sized, but let it be direct. Minister it wherever the need is or the blessing is to be, in Jesus' name. Amen. One with God, one with the Father. Probably 40 years ago now, I remember in a church down the road talking to my father. I said, Dad, in those days I probably, maybe I'd have been a little more direct. Maybe I would have been a little shy, not so direct. I don't know. I'm going to give it to you in words of today. Have you ever noticed only the spiritual bulldogs are developing into mediators? Got it? Only the spiritual bulldogs are becoming mediators. Meat what? Not milk, meat of the Word of God, instruction. Those greatly motivated, they view spiritual truth and personal fellowship with the Lord through a single eye. They don't deviate. I mean, that's it. Sometimes our words reflect that. Their commitment, their goal, their mountain is to experience personally today life to be lived as defined in the written word. This they do by making the word personal. Okay? Personal fellowship, partnership, communion, participation, sharing has diminished in recognition since Pentecost. I don't mean to be negative. That's not my intent. But I do need to be absolutely frank with you. All right? And blunt. How did it happen? It happened by Satan's deceit and the church agreement by turning fellowship into tradition.
Good word.
You got that? Defined best by one word, compromise. Got it? Wherever compromise enters the body of Christ, you are doing away with fellowship with Him. But I would only be half right when I say that, because there is fellowship with another. Sad to say, we tend to go vertical and exempt going horizontal. Okay? Because you know what you're going to find there, people are not going to agree with you. They're going to say it in words that you understand, or you don't understand, or. But to go horizontal, you've got to be willing to discuss the issues. Not without raising up in judgment, you don't have to take what they say, but you're going to have to come to a place where you can have an ongoing conversation with those laterally. Don't go there, because we're going to spend a lot of this morning talking about not going there or going there. Got it? And the results of that. Sometimes we just resist that with a passion. People will go out of their way, believers will go out of their way to talk to one another and leave everything that they don't agree with alone. How can you ever become one with that? One another. You say, have you ever been guilty? Perhaps. But anyhow, where there's been compromise, let me just back up for a minute, because there's a whole paragraph here that I found that the bulldog people looking for spiritual meat, these determined spiritual seekers have found few to assist them in their spiritual quest. That was my issue with Dad. Here you have a church. What are you doing for the incoming Christians Not everybody comes in as spiritual bulldogs. Not everybody. Some is more timid. How do you go about strengthening these to become meat eaters? They need to be meat eaters. See, but they got to understand the bulldogs, people look at them skeptically. A part of the body of Christ looks at them skeptically. You ever notice? They, with little to offer, I think even in the beginning, the spiritual bulldogs' goals were unclear, perhaps, other than they knew that they knew they had to find out what was truth. I needed to know where I was spiritual at daily, weekly, hourly. And as one that was thirsting for the things of God, I couldn't live without knowing where I was at. Nobody give me answers. I headed for the basement. I'll come out of here when I know what I need to know. When I come out of here, I found out I could ask a yes or no question and get a yes or no response. But you're going to have to focus on it. You're going to have to commit to it. And he has what is necessary for you to live victorious. That is just fact. But you're going to apply, you're going to step out, you're going to look, you're going to examine, and you're going to believe him. It's just the way it is. Jesus, in his final prayer of intercession on earth, included you and me. Don't you like that? He included you and me. In the 17th chapter of John. The conclusion of his prayer covered these points. Are you ready? One with God, one with another, demonstrating his love, his glory. Why? That the world may believe. If you don't want to grow laterally as well as vertically, the world will not believe. Simple as that. You cast a vote. John 17, 21 through 23. And they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me. I said, don't you just love this? Jesus is praying that our oneness would be as him and the Father was one. You say, well, that is a pie in the sky. No, that's a reality on earth, fixed with heaven. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee. That they also may be one in us. It's vertical. Got it? That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them that they may be one. Even as, same as, surely as we are one. He has already given you the template. Huh? He did. He gave you the template. I and them, thou and me, he reinforces it, that they may be made perfect, complete, entire in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them as thou hast loved me. The world will not know the love of God until you love them. Is that what it says? That's exactly what it says. The model is one. It's revealed as divine, one in us, is the union and fellowship as modeled by the Son and the Father. They put themselves on display for us. Do I need to repeat that? They put themselves on display for us. Are you willing to go on display for others and him? Wait a minute. That's going to make me uncomfortable. I'm going to have to pull the rock off my hole. Or the brush out of the way. Whatever it is. Whoa. Are you sure I have to get this extreme? He went on display for us. They went on display for us. One is one living unit. That is, this living eternal unit may be one in us. This is the standard which we are called to conform. In is the state, the condition, the circumstance in which a person is. One in us is the eternal state, the spiritual unity of one with God, one with another, demonstrating His love, His glory, that the world may believe. We're on. We're entering an electronic generation. Are you ready? We're going to enter it together. Oh boy. Okay. One with God, one with another. Now you see this, I'll tell you, I didn't build this. Dale says, don't tell who did it. So I haven't told. Is that, I trust that's true. But this guy right here, I will tell you this, Pastor Angela says that if that's Jesus, he's holding his breath. See, he's turning purple. He's waiting. Okay, there is the body of Christ. Jesus sitting there as the head. Notice, he always made the first move to you, did he not? Right there it is. See this big arrow? Yep. Oh, you're a right hand. Over there is the left hand, or however it works. You're one of these hands for our lesson today. Got it? You are part of the body of Christ. All right, so he made this move outside here. He made this move outside here. Now look at. See this? This is you going back to him. Got it? Oh, you love it, don't you? Don't you? I could ask over here, but I know the answer. I could go to this extreme, and he'd know the answer. And you'll just love being in him. Where he is, you are. You just love it. You're just ecstatic. Yeah, ain't it the truth? Anybody notice anything about those arrows going up and down? What do you notice about them, Gary? Those things are solid. Notice that? Okay, Brother Lynn, what is these? I didn't ask the designer of this guy to make this broken, but I just love that they're broken, at least for accuracy reasons of the illustration. Notice? They're going back and forth. There's gaps in it. Yeah. You're up and down. Your vertical is better than your lateral. Okay? You go back and forth with God, with Him, easily. You don't do this so easily. Is that true? Don't answer. Luke says, and he answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, strengthen with all thy mind. All, any, ever, or the whole. He's looking for a complete package. And you say, I think I'd give him a complete package. Okay. And thy neighbor as thyself. Has he got the complete package? Who's my neighbor? Worldwide people, your neighbor. You may not agree with him, but they're your neighbor. What about the guy that kicked me in the shins? Or. If he despitefully uses you, what are you supposed to do? Say good things to him? Yeah. Well, that takes a bit of a challenge if you're anybody like some of us. I could tell you about McDonald's this morning. Why does everybody get a chuckle? This one over here gets a particular chuckle. I want to tell you, I passed this morning. I drove up early. I give them my order. They was right there. I give them my order. Cheerful guy on the end of the machine. I drove up. Cheerful guy there. I says, your day must be about done. Yeah. Give me my money cheerfully, my change. I went on to the next window, and nobody showed up. And nobody showed up. And nobody showed up. I peeked my neck up and saw, what am I going to get for coffee? And there was about yay much in the bottom of the thing there. I pretty well made up my mind. I waited long enough. I wasn't going to drink that. So finally a guy stumbled around there and found out there's somebody waiting for his coffee. So he looked at the coffee. I said, One guy headed for the back, and the other one, brave soul he was, come to the window and begin to explain to me they didn't have any, a lot of fresh coffee. I said, I'm glad you're talking about fresh. I'll wait right here. So he made me a pot of coffee. I took two cups and drove away. Tranquil. Yeah. That is awesome. You know, that is divine. That is trying to make up this little line right here so there's not so many gaps in it. Eh? Eh? Hey, whoa, next screen, please. Notice with us, we're one with God, one with another, and we have to esteem others better than themselves. Now that gets right down to the point where it pinches the shoe. You ever notice? That pinches the shoe. Esteem. Well, I don't have the right thing here. Okay. Boy, we went to Philippians 2, 1 through 3, and got this right here. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, now you want that interpreted, inner sympathy, affection, tender mercies is wrapped up in those words right there. Now, you extend them to this way, don't you? Hello. This way, right? Now, second verse, fulfill. You come across these words, full, fulfill, and that sort of thing. Get excited, okay? Get excited. It's perfectly legitimate to get excited. Because what is he saying here? Fulfill ye my joy. Well, that sounds good. Now, let me add a little something to that. Cram up my net with joy. Because that's the definition of fulfill. Cram a net full, level it off. Crammed up your net of joy, that ye be like-minded, having the, what? The same love. Oh my. Being of one accord? Oh my, my. Being of one mind? My, my, my. Woo! Esteem another. Esteem the other. Let nothing, not even one thing, be done through strife, intrigue. Contention. Let not one thing be done through that. Okay. You can tell somebody. You can tell the world. You can tell these people, wherever the laws are being written, that I don't have to marry. I refuse to marry a homosexual. You can tell them that. Cheerfully, in love, and get ready to go to jail. Pack your bag, or have mama bring you some. Nothing wrong with that. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. That's empty glory. Empty, empty, empty. That's self-conceit. But in lowliness of mind, let each one another esteem, consider the other, ready? Above, superior to themselves. Oh, my, 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 my. That's what it says. Now then, move on to the next screen. Are we ready for this? Whoo! We are from one life source, the head. One. As thou hast given him power, given him power. God the Father had given him, Jesus, power. Delegated authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life as to many as thou hast given him. Wow. Yeah. And this is life eternal. This word life is Zoe, is life as God has it, and this is life as God has it, eternal. That they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. No. That no is absolutely no. Not N-O, it's K-N-O-W. Absolutely no. Next screen. Wow. A question. Oh, I don't. I would like to ask this and go up and down the aisle, but I know better. Because what comes next may generate a frown or two. after this. Are we ready? Are we ready for this adventure? Say yes. Sure. Are we most comfortable being alone with God? Are we? Are we most comfortable being alone with God? Vertical. Are we most comfortable being there? Yeah. I got a yes. I got a head nod. Why are we more comfortable? Next screen. What do we? Do we call this security and comfort? Huh? Being alone with him. It's security and comfort. You know he's there. You know you're there. You're comforted. Man, you like this. Amen, brother. I do. Are you think he's going to toss you out with a wash or something? Eh? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? You got something, and you're clinging to it. Who shall separate you from that? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword? Answer, no. Another three verses of it, and it comes to verse 39. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, no other creature. Creature, creation. I'm a creation, you're a creation. Those guys outside the wall are creations. Are they going to be able to separate me? Shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus? Not if I won't be separated. Whoa, Lynn, are you revved a little? Hang on. Because I'm going to share something with you. I won't tell you who was with me. At breakfast the other morning, when we got right knee deep into this discussion, and I admit there might have been an emotion or two running the gambit. You ever get in discussions where emotions run the gambit a little bit? Well, I think, next screen, we shall see. We call this security and comfort when we cling to it ourselves and will not share it. That is selfish or selfishness. Wait a minute. And you ought to have seen two expressions. The guy across the table from me and mine too. Because this come roaring out of me, not by a pre-thought, but when I want to dwell in him in security and comfort, in ecstasy, if you will, with pimples and motions going all over the place, and I will not give this up, nor will I share it. That is my comfort. That is my security. And I don't have to share it. Huh? It is maybe uncomfortable. Now, you say, Lynn, how can you say these things to me? You know me. I know all of you in one form or another. All right? I have examined some of you over prayer, over excitement, and through things. I'm going to give you, if you're uptight at the moment, I'm going to give you a slight out coming up. What's the next screen? If that selfishness is more about me than others, you're not doing very good on this thing right here. Are you? Huh? Whoa, Lynn. You've done rocked the boat now. I said the bulldog in the beginning found few that assisted him. Because shortly, that bulldog got out into areas that were not common, where there was compromise. The Spirit of God was not. Or diminished. Have you ever been there, Lynn? I tell you, I've heard things from God that I would refuse to share. Diane said, it'd make you uncomfortable. That wasn't really my problem. On being uncomfortable for me was not the issue. Being uncomfortable was just an issue of life. All right? Because I was uncomfortable, I was odd from the beginning. I've told you. I got to whining to God one day. I was born again, spirit-filled. Things were happening. And I said, why is it, God, that I'm always a half a step out of sequence from mankind, from rest of Christendom? You know, identify with that? He says, do you want to be like him? I knew in that instant that was my choice. I said, no, sir, I can't afford the luxury. Can't afford it. Cannot afford it. But I still set on things. He'd share things with me, and I'd hoard it to myself. Some of them, I tell you, there was a thing. I hoarded to myself for years. On John S.'s tractor, I told you before, on John S.'s tractor, a bunch of kids were in a wagon, and one of the young women got up and come up and sat on the fender and asked me, pertinent to the same question that drove me to my basement years ago, and I had not told a living soul about that experience. Not a one. And I said, dear Lord, can I tell her now? Can I tell it now? Tell it. So I told her. How to get a yes or no answer from God for me. She took it. I don't know if she got it applied in her life or not. All I had to do was tell her. Now then. But for me, a few days later, I was going through, I was somewhere in somebody's house when a Kenneth Hagin magazine was there. And on open to the same page, says this: how to get a yes or no answer from God. He was always doing that to me. If I would talk about it, he would affirm it. You see? If I would talk about it, he would affirm it. And don't think he's run out of blessings. You see, we got to get over that. You're not giving away something that he can't return multiple fold over. You see, you are flat. Selfish selfishness. Do you have something from God that you hoard to yourself? You're what? How do I define you? The one word that jumped out this week was selfish, or in a state of selfishness. God withheld, for the record, God withheld nothing from you. He did not give you his extra or his overflow. Huh? He gave you his best, nothing but the best, his perfect lamb, Jesus Christ. In your search, you found an oasis of intimacy. Yet the person next to you is dying of thirst. Eh? Wow. This intimacy is marked by a very close association of oneness. You have instant contact, including a familiarity of long association. You rightfully reserve for yourself the intimate conversations, the words of love, including feelings, emotions, and atmosphere. They are rightfully yours. Rightfully, they're yours. But hang on. Please consider, we must share with others the process, the result, along with the effect. Can we do that? We don't have to give away the secrets, but the method, the means, the opportunity, it's there for you. Again, consider. Meeting the needs of physical man is extremely important. Right? There is no fellowship. There is no replacement for fellowship with others. This fellowship horizontally should resemble and reflect your vertical relationship with him. Ephesians 4:25, for ye are members one of another, members a limb, a part of the body, one of another, your own mutual, together or in union with. You are unable to give away so much that he cannot resupply you or give you additionally. Psalms 84:11, for the Lord God is the sun, the shield, the Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold or keep back from them that walk uprightly. The Hebrews of that is entire, complete, perfect, and whole. I'm not going to give you unless you cry that you want them. The next 10 verses that I have scheduled. I won't ask for a vote. If you want to take, I might be able to do it in 10 minutes. Do you want them? Do you want the next 10 verses, these last 10 verses today? Do you want them?
Yes.
Okay. Linda votes. I hear Paul. And I'll do it as simply and as directly as I can. Because this is a living illustration of that man that was standing over there in a stick figure. This is Paul talking about the church at Corinth or the Corinthians. And here's what he says. In my words, Paul defines the Corinthians' exalted position and state of grace in the first 9 verses. Let me give them to you. Paul called or invited, pointed to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will, the good pleasure of God. You're called to be saints, it's going to say in the next verse. Sacred, morally blameless, consecrated. Morally blameless, I think we'd jump all over that. That's how he views you, morally blameless. Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both in theirs. Paul has nothing but good things to say about these Corinthians in this first 9 verses. And this is how it starts. Sanctified, set apart in Christ, made holy, purified, sanctified, grace, in verse 3, favor be unto you, peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, peace to join, quietness, rest, set at one again, security, safety, prosperity. Got that? That's that relationship going back and forth, up and down. That in everything you be enriched. Oops. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given or bestowed you by Jesus Christ. That in everything, verse 5, that you be enriched by him in all, enriched by him in all utterance, in all knowledge. In everything that you be enriched. Make rich, spiritual riches, in all utterance, in all knowledge. This is to know the truth, and the truth sets you free. These Corinthians are soon going to have more truth on their plate. They go to sit here and they're getting happy. Can you see them getting happy? They're reading this and Paul's saying all these things to them, powerful things. Can you see them? Puffing up, maybe. Even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, or the witness of Christ was confirmed in you, made sure, established, so that you come behind in no gift. And you come behind in no gift. You come behind in no gift. It's not late. It's not tardy. It's there. You don't come behind in it. Matter of fact, I'll just go on record. You're neither late, inferior, nor deficient in any spiritual gift. That's the status today. Okay? Wow. That's the status of those Corinthians, who also confirm you unto the end. Confirm you, establish you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. Or he guarantees his workmanship right up to the moment of Christ's return. Got it? You're guaranteed. You got a ticket, it's punched, ready to go. Good. Wow. You are blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. That which cannot be called into an account is unreprovable, unaccused, and blameless. God is first. God is faithful. In verse 9, by whom you are called unto the fellowship. Koinonia. Remember that word from a few weeks ago. Koinonia. Fellowship. We think in terms of relationship. He thinks in terms of fellowship. This is fellowship, communion, partnership, partakers, sharing, intimate fellowship, intimate fellowship. This is them in verse 1 through 9. They have an exalted standing in Christ, yet they are divided and not one. How do you know that, Lynn? Verse 10. Ready for verse 10. Now I beseech you. Wow. I call you near. I invite you. I invoke you. I exhort you. I give you exhortation. I entreat you. I pray, brethren, born of the same blood of the same Father, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. Woo! Hello? Hello? I don't care. You got to come back to the source, the guide into all truth, the Holy Spirit. You sit there, wait on Him. You will all be at a point in time that you all speak the same thing. I didn't just put this in the book for this morning. I just didn't do that. It's been there for generations. Oh, I'm glad it's there. Huh? How many of you speak the same thing? We're talking about one with God, one with another. He's talking about all of us speak the same things. We got to come to that place. There be no divisions among you. Oh my. But that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. He just don't give you any rest, does he? Huh? Wow. Well, brother of the same blood, of the same Father, that all of you, every one of you, the wholeness of you, it's awesome the degree of unity Paul expects. Okay? Speak the same thing to say or affirm, that there be no divisions among you, rent, division, dissension, schism, that you be perfectly joined together. Now that word perfectly just sends you right into shudders. Perfectly joined together is all the same Greek word. Same definition, perfectly joined together. If you go dodge perfectly, you got to still deal with joined together. Have at it. I'll help you though. It's to render fit, sound, complete, equipped, put in order, arranged, and adjusted. You feel like you've been adjusted any this morning? Okay. Wow. In the same mind, same together mind, intellect, mind, thoughts, feelings, will, same together judgment. Judgment. What can judgment be? It's opinion, mind, concerning what ought to be or what ought to be done by oneself, resolve, intention. Why? Why? So that you are. Can we have that one page of the PowerPoint, please? I don't care which page. Wow. I'm practically done. We've gone. Here it is. Here's the body. Hey, we're going here. He wants these gaps to be removed. He wants us going left and right. He wants us to be of the same. He wants us to be one with God, one with another, demonstrating His love, His glory, that the world may believe. Simple as that. That's not just to look skeptical at your neighbor. That's not to talk with. That's not to get up and run on his shoulder, stand on his shoulder, beat him on the head. It's to love him, communicate with him. If they turn away and won't receive, there's nothing you can do about that. Go in peace. That's what we're called to do. But if they start to listen, I don't care if they even yell at you. How many people have I had yell at me? Yell. And my natural reaction is to raise my voice. I'll let you in on a secret. I probably have. But we have got to come to the place where we can love in the midst of unlovely situations. Love one another. I brought us together as a family this morning to hear this because I thought it was very important. Because the world is to believe, and it starts with us. And it starts with all the body of Christ worldwide. Nobody gets out of it. Father, we thank you. To me, this is wondrous truth this morning. Wondrous truth. When it's orchestrated, when it's put into action, the world will believe. When the church is one, the world will be one, W-O-N. When the body of Christ is one, the world will be one, W-O-N. Thank you. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the revelation. Thank you for your goodness and mercy. Thank you. Wow. Father, let us go with your blessing as you want. Any of you that like to stay and pray, feel free to do so. I just thank you for listening. We consider what we've heard and go with you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.